Good evening and welcome to The Checkpoint right here at Urban TV. My name is Nicholas Wasanja. Our guest tonight is a distinguished lawyer. He has done everything law, from the academia to drafting constitutions, a kind of practice that seldom happens. He was a member of the Justice Benjamin Odoche Commission that drafted the 1995 Constitution. He has chaired the reviewing of the same document. He has had an input in making of constitutions across the region in Kenya and South Sudan, severally leading the Uganda Law Society and the East African Community Law Society. He is a senior counsel of the High Court of Uganda, the highest ranking honor of the legal fraternity. The professor has practiced the law in and outside of the courtrooms for over 50 years. Our guest tonight is the founding partner of Katende and Sempebwa Company Advocates. Professor Frederick Sempebwa, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Professor, how are you holding up in this lockdown?
Well, as you found me, in the lockdown, but I'm not really bored. I have been going ahead with the work of the office as well as my personal work. We as a firm have continued to work at a distance through our meetings and through contacts to our clients. Even some of us who were born before computers now are aware of the new norm and we have to abide. And you found me at home, which is really a firm home. We have things to do here. We rear animals, we grow crops. So that occupies me quite a lot. Yeah.
Well, Professor, today we are going to talk about constitutionalism in the face of COVID-19. But before we go into the beef of that discussion, we would want to get a question out of the way. One of the questions that has been lingering in many of our minds is, when you chaired the 2005 Review Commission, Constitutional Review Commission, you as a chairperson wrote a minority report, something that was out of the normal. It is unusual that the chairman writes a minority report. One would wonder what exactly went wrong.
Well, it's simply a strong disagreement with the majority of the members of the commission. I felt so strongly, and me and my colleague, the late Sam Owori, felt so strongly about one particular issue that we thought the country should know where we stand. And that is an issue that had built up emotions among the people. So we thought it was unusual as a chair, but since then you've seen a lot of minority reports coming up. I think I opened the way. It was not normal, but things start that way. I thought that the country should know that there was an alternative view on this particular issue of removing the term limits. Yeah. But I agree with you, it wasn't normal. We agreed on the report, and I did the last drafting, except on this particular issue.
Except on that particular issue.
Yes.
Since then, Professor, several amendments have been made in the same constitution. Would you today say the document is a finer one setting Uganda on a right legal path?
No, I can't really say that it is better than where the Odoche Commission left it or where the Constitutional Review Commission left it. There are crucial matters that have been amended which were not allowed to. Normally you do some amendments which are driven by experience. You may find through practice that the provisions you made in the Constitution do not work. all that their changed circumstances requiring changes. But some of the amendments have not been driven by experience. I have in mind, for example, the removal of the term limits, because the term limit was removed before it was even put in operation. So we couldn't tell whether the people had made the wrong decision or not. You cannot say a constitution shouldn't be amended, but should be amended and driven by changes, and you want to better it in view of the changed circumstances.
Was there any other way that it could have been done other than the way your commission did it?
I think what has been lacking is thorough consultation, because this is a people's constitution. It came from the people. And if there are crucial matters which are not routine amendments, I think the wisest thing to do is to engage in thorough consultation of the people, which has not been lacking. We did attempt in the Constitutional Review Commission again to consult the people, but many of our recommendations were not affected, but what we have seen is now amendments of crucial parts without consultation, thorough consultation. Yes, you can talk about consultation. Members of Parliament are convinced that they did the consultation. I'm talking about really referring the framers, the originators of the Constitution. Who are the people? Yeah.
Professor, but around that same time, a referendum was held to decide on whether to continue in a movement system of governance or reintroduce malpartism in the country. Why didn't probably the same question would have been put to the same people and decide on the fate of that particular article?
Yeah, I agree. That, in fact, that was the recommendation of the majority on the Constitutional Review Commission, and hence the recommendation of my commission, but it wasn't taken. I've just said that most of our recommendations were not effected, but I agree with you, that is a matter that could have been decided upon, and the democracy would have demanded that whatever the people came up with, you accept it. They could have reached a new understanding of the situation, that you don't need age limits. Many countries don't have age limits. They don't exist in US, they don't exist in Britain. And I also would agree that you don't need an age limit so long as you have a term limit. But it would have been up to the people to say, look, age is a number. Let's have someone we want, someone wise, whether he's 90 or approaching 100 with one leg in the grave, it's okay. He can take us further.
Professor, depending on what side of what angle you're standing at, one would say, well, perhaps the term limits were lifted, but we are still moving as a country. Do you think in any particular way lifting or scrapping of the term limits from the Constitution has a way that it has impacted on the governance question in Uganda?
Yeah, I think the most of the dissatisfaction among politicians on the opposition and so on is this feeling that there is this grown up what is called the power of incumbency, that when someone lasts long in power, he acquires that aura, that power. He commands the instruments of government, and there is suspicion that these instruments of government are used to deter others from accessing power. And this is also, you know, spurred on by what is happening normally, where opposition politicians are not free, they are not allowed to exercise their rights freely. So that suspicion grows, and there's a tendency to believe that has come out of the power of incumbency. All the people serving in these instruments of power think that their job is to sustain the people in power. So that is the situation as it has built up. It may not be realistic. What the opposition is fronting may not be true, but you know, appearances can also bring about a lot of problems. Yeah.
Professor, since then, several amendments have been made. Recently, the age limits were scrapped, like you've said. Electoral reforms, government brought a bill before Parliament, and it was subsequently passed. The legal committee in Parliament is currently scrutinizing a litany of electoral reforms from private members. But it seems like there is no end in sight in the way the legislature deals with these amendments. Do you think as a country there is any other way that we can resolve our governance issues other than simply amending the constitution?
Yes, in order to avoid this feeling that amendments are being effected to serve the interests of particular groups, I think we need another conversation. We had a thorough conversation in 1895. That was very useful. What came out of that is not really the document by itself, the constitution, but the consensus that was built through this dialogue. The satisfaction that the people of Uganda have now agreed that henceforth we are going to govern ourselves in this particular manner. That was the most valuable thing that we got out of that conversation, that consultation. And from what has developed, from all these suspicions we have, conflicts amongst the people, I think a conversation would do us good. Sort of a national, you can devise ways, not necessarily the consultation of Odochi, that is thorough, that is the best, but you could have a dialogue, a national conference of representatives of all interest groups in the country. You don't discriminate. Whoever someone has something to say, it should be represented. That would assist us. Then we'll build a consensus.
The Interreligious Council of Uganda has proposed that we should have a national dialogue. But there seems to be that the only remaining issue seems to be the differences in political affiliations. That seems to be the sticky issue, agreeing on how to hold a national dialogue. What would you advise as an expert in these issues?
I'm not very clear about the problem, about the dialogue, but I think the the most important thing is not to exclude groups. Whatever group exists that has some grievance, whatever political party, religious, ethnic, and so on and so on, they should sit together. We should sit together and come to some understanding. They did this in South Africa, and you'd wonder that they went at pains to include people of beliefs like homosexuals and said, but these are our people. They have their own thinking about sexuality. We cannot exclude them from the dialogue. So if the religious, this religious driven dialogue is meant to collect all interest groups together, it is welcome. It could also be one way of finding a solution. But then it should also include people in government. It should not be a purely private matter, because then the government can turn around and say, ah, but these are religious people, they did their thing. It doesn't bother us.
The fear has been perhaps the funding of that process, whereas there are those that think that, well, government should fund the process because it's a national issue. Those that are opposed to government think that perhaps if government funds the process, it will hold everyone else at ransom. How could this be resolved? And picking lessons from Kenya, do you think the Kenyan process that led to a new constitution would be anything to go by? Have they made any progress in that line?
They did. I think it is they have very good lessons for us. They started with particular groups, the lawyers, religious people, and so on, meeting on their own and airing their views, and later on combining in a people-driven dialogue without the involvement of the government. At one time, the people-driven dialogue even embarked on drafting a constitution for Kenya. So it reached a point where they became credible, because they were not exclusive. They were they had a representative, people-driven dialogue towards the new constitution. And until the government woke up also and said, we must have an official dialogue. Let's join in. So the government also sets up theirs. And that the Guy Commission on reviewing the Constitution of Kenya thought it fit to absorb the people-driven dialogue and say, you are important, we must work together. So either way, if the dialogue is not funded by government, that is not something to stop the originators from going ahead and seeking. The fear is that whoever, what is the saying about the piper or something?
Who pays the piper?
We'll call the tune. I think that's the fear, that if government funds, then they might influence the outcome. But I don't think that when you have people of integrity sitting in these dialogues, that will be necessarily influenced by the fact. But also the man of dialogue matters. If these funds are clear, the cabinet has agreed, parliament has come in and voted the funds, and they are put into an autonomous body that will determine the expenditure and so on, then I don't see influence coming in. So there must be openness about the issue. Of course, when you talk about a new conversation, there will be people will come up and say, no, we don't have the money, we went through it under Doki, under Sempewa, but there is no need, especially now that there is a lot to talk about the pandemic, how we should prevent it, how money should be devoted. So there will be these arguments, but then we've seen a lot of expenditure being justified on account of democracy, that democracy is expensive, so we must have a large house, parliament, people must be represented, must be satisfied with them. So money is spent, and what better way to ensure that we have stability, peace and stability?
Peace and stability.
Through understanding each other's opinions.
You talk of understanding each other's opinions, but there is an emerging difference between the three arms of government, the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary. And this stems from that point of the money point, where Parliament allocated itself resources, and then this pact kind of like an exchange between the executive and the legislature, and then downplaying each other's roles, and it's sucked in the judiciary. Do you think at this, amongst the challenges that COVID has brought to the fore, the doctrine of separation of powers has also been tested?
Yes, it is tested, but it can't be shaken, because it's not really a separation of powers, but integrity of functions amongst these organs of government. There should be cooperation and respect for each other's functions. And cooperation is a must, because the Constitution decrees it. The Constitution requires that the organs of government work together. It's a common purpose. But it also decrees that they continuously look at each other and try to correct mistakes. This is what we call checks and balances. They are there. The president has power, but occasionally these powers must be exercised through approval by parliament. Parliament has legislative powers. But also their powers are curbed, because they must function within the law. And if they don't, the judiciary comes in and says, you haven't functioned through the law, so that is wrong. So the requirement is collaboration. If this, you call it the cause of misunderstanding is money, but that's a small matter. To me, money, if it had been voted and everyone had known the purpose, where it is going, apparently no one knew. If the president didn't know, who else knew? Because normally the government, the executive, which also participates.
Is it a question of lack of communication?
Communication, yes, because it may well be that this money was needed by members of parliament, and was going to be put on good use, but because of this lack of communication, the people failed that the parliament is awarding themselves some allowance for this difficult period, and hence even the president was the first to say, that money should now go to the task forces in the districts. But the court said, because the court was acting on the instigation of one person, one or two, who felt that the law had not been followed in approving these expenditures. So for it, acting on that information, said, fine, they don't use it. And they return it to the treasury.
But if there is a...
Now, you can't say this is a conflict, because the judiciary was doing its work. Yes, and they are the ones to determine the legality of action. So they did. The conflict comes when another organ of government says we cannot obey a judicial decision.
So how do you come out of that as a country? If one organ says, we are not going to obey, you follow my orders, how do you come out?
Fortunately, it didn't go to that. It stopped midway. But there are ways of dealing with the people who disobey court orders. So it could have gone to that. It even includes being condemned for contempt, which could lead even to your arrest and so on. But it didn't go to that, fortunately. But I'm saying strictly under the law, it would have gone to that.
Perhaps we are about to see the worst, because it continues to unfold. But Professor, you talked of the issue of communication, lack of communication within the government systems. What does, if something as simple as communication, yet very paramount, lacks within government systems, what does this say about our leadership as a country?
Well, you probably have answered the question, because communication is so important. We get disturbances arising out of suspicions, out of wrong information, out of fake news. These days we use that expression, or fake information, and emotions build up on the basis of misinformation. So we need to get back to a position where everyone is open. Yeah.
Professor, still under the same circumstance, voices came out of Parliament that perhaps the way the executive was handling the COVID crisis, the pandemic, declaring, making declarations using the Health Act, yet we have a state of emergency, there is a legal issue there. How do you read into this?
Yeah, I understand some people, including lawyers, were reasoning that people's rights were being curbed in a situation where an emergency had not been declared. Normally you tamper with the people's rights of movement, of what, when there's a state of emergency. But I think they hadn't analyzed the situation properly. What has been happening is that the Minister of Health has got powers under certain law, a very old law, call it the Public Health Act, which authorizes this minister to issue other sub-laws, we call them statutory instruments, in case there is an outbreak of dangerous diseases. At the time when this law was made, the diseases which were known were leprosy, cholera, and smallpox. COVID was not in the situation. But the law is so well framed that any outbreak is catered for. So what we've been doing, what we've been living under, are these statutory instruments, whereby the minister acting under that law says movement is restricted, entry into the country is prohibited, and so on and so on. It's all there. So we are not even living under the commands of the president, because he wouldn't have power.
But that has been the feeling that
The president simply announces what cabinet has agreed and will go into this law that is signed by the honorable minister. And these laws have been signed. They exist.
Professor, the laws have been signed, but actually it came up this week again. And one of the MPs was arguing that these statutory instruments are being used in reverse order, that the president first makes the declaration and then the attorney general runs to parliament to bring the statutory instruments. What does this mean exactly?
Well, I don't know how the order is, but what I know are these, that these instruments are it may be a bit faulty for the orders to be issued before the law is made. That gap, I think, is what the Honourable Member of Parliament is thinking about, that gap. But we all know, although strictly there may be a gap where there is a lack of legality, but we know very well that, like the most recent extension, we know there was a gap between, Monday and Wednesday. But I'm sure by now the statutory instrument is being made. All it was made, but it hadn't been published. But that is how it acts.
Dear viewers, we are speaking to Professor Frederick Sempebwa, a founding partner in Katende and Sempebwa Company Advocates. We are going to go for a very short break, but when we return, the professor will be telling us what the COVID-19 crisis means to the electoral roadmap that Uganda was supposed to go into early in 2021. Let's break. Welcome back from that short break. We are speaking to Professor Frederick Sempebwa, the founding partner of Katende and Sempebwa Company Advocates. Professor, there are proposals that perhaps elections should be postponed. Yala MPs are saying to as long as 3 years. What does this mean to, what's your take on this? Is there a legal backing within which these proposals are being made?
Well, what I've heard is even proposals that we don't have elections. And I think it's a grave situation. We know very well that under these circumstances, sticking to a roadmap might be impossible. On the other hand, it's good for our country, for democracy to continue. There will be a lot of misunderstandings in cancelling the election. In fact, for me, cancelling an election is not an option. It's simply like seizing power, what was done by Obote in 1966. But unilaterally continuing the tenure. The tenure of people in power, the tenure of parliament, which determines our next election, is 5 years, and they are due to expire before the election. 5 years, the constitution says parliament stands dissolved after the period of 5 years. Now, the only possibility of extending the life of parliament is where an emergency exists, where there is such a disturbance that no election can be conducted. And my interpretation of this is not simply a pandemic, because a pandemic can be managed. Our president has managed it very well. We are now going into seizure of restrictions. So, to me, there isn't a state of emergency that stops an election. But that is the constitutional provision, that the life of parliament, which determines our next election, can be extended, but also to limited periods, being extended in accordance with the state of the situation. If the danger continues and nothing can be done. In my interpretation, everything can be done for us to have an election. It will be a changed shape of election because we are now working under the danger of a disease. Just as our mode of working and life has changed. So everything that we do, including an election, will have to change. And to me, what is possible is to tinker around with the constitution and the electoral laws to make sure that we have a free and fair election. This is in the interest of everyone, the government, members of parliament, of the ruling party, and of the opposition. Everyone is working towards a free and fair election. So, therefore, if the roadmap cannot be adhered to, that may sort of constrain the fairness of an election. For example, the presidential aspirants did not have time to consult. That is within the roadmap, within the law. Therefore, in order to enable them to have those 90 days or so, you have to extend to adjust the roadmap through changes in the constitution and the law. There will be difficulties in campaigning because of the distances that will be allowed. So using the modes of technology and so on, you have to find ways of enabling people to consult the aspirants, the candidates, to consult the people. So to me, saying there will be no election is not an option. And the extension, which is reasonable in order to adjust the roadmap, would be okay. And I think every stakeholder would have no problem with that.
You point at the importance of holding elections under the constitution. But in one of the recent interviews, the president pointed at, seemed laid back on the issue and emphasizing that in case the pandemic persists, then probably we might have to do without it. Don't you think this tests the gravity of constitutionalism, that the country is, constitutionalism is losing its gravity in the face of COVID-19?
I didn't hear or see what the president said, but I would like to interpret his opinion as saying we may have to postpone a little the roadmap so that we have elections not in February, but maybe in April next year. This is how I would like to interpret, but I cannot imagine that he was saying that we shall not have an election, because that one is a coup. It's just exactly what Obote did, and that coup would also require a state of emergency. At least it could be remotely justified, although even then it would not acquire legitimacy. Just as Obote's coup never acquired legitimacy until he was removed. Yeah.
Professor, currently Parliament is scrutinizing the administration of the judiciary's bill. And one of the issues that comes up is making the judiciary a fully autonomous entity that is self-accounting to ensure that its independence is sustained. But one would wonder that, for example, Parliament determines its emoluments, whichever way you look at it. But time and again, you've seen executive interfering with its work and turning around its decisions. Do you think enshrining in the law the independence of the judiciary will help stem this challenge?
Yeah, now when we talk about the judiciary, there are two aspects. There's the institutional independence, the independence of the institution, and that can be assisted and enhanced by the bill you've talked about, which would also enable the judiciary to control its own funds, to budget and appropriate money, so that the work of the institution is not hampered. Right now, most of the capital expenditures, development expenditures are suspended. The judiciary gets money literally for payment of salaries and so on and so on. This bill is meant at institutional independence. When you talk about the other independence of each individual judges being able to decide without any interference from everyone, that comes out of integrity. The integrity that is attached to the post, but also to the capacity given to the judges to act independently. And one of the things people have been complaining about is the lack of sufficient facilitation in terms of salaries, office accommodation, assistants, and so on, which enhances the independence of individual judicial officers. But also, the issue of integrity comes in, which you can hardly provide for under the law. That's why judges are always scrutinized, and the people going to assume that office are scrutinized up to a point that everyone thinks we've got people of integrity.
Do you think there is an amount of money that can ensure or sustain integrity in the institution?
No, there isn't, because we've seen very rich people getting corrupt. There isn't. Money is not the absolute guarantee of integrity. But on the other hand, if members of the judiciary are so underpaid, then the temptation grows. And to me, comparatively, they're underpaid. If you look at the remuneration of members of parliament and you compare it with the members of the judiciary, they are really underpaid. So there is a lot to be done in this area.
But everyone seems to be agreeing that yes, the judiciary should be facilitated better. But beyond remuneration, what other ways can corruption be stemmed in the institution? Because it seems to be a long-standing public outcry.
The only way is for us to be open. What has been happening is the people are complaining, they are whispering to each other, the judiciary is corrupt, they are drawing up curves of corruption and so on. But when it comes to being open and using the proper channels of us following up on that alleged corruption and eliminating it, people are not forthcoming. We have a Judicial Service Commission. And one of its functions is to look into this area. I've served on this commission, and I can guarantee to you that very rarely would you get complaints relating to the corruption of a judge. Rarely. And if you got it and scrutinize it very well, you might have, in so many cases, you would have to find that what the complainant is coming up with is that he has lost. There's so many complaints of this nature arising out of losing a case. So I can't have lost unless this judge is corrupt. That is...
So it's normally just a gut feeling?
Yes, yes. So when you have analyzed it, you find he has not brought any evidence that the judge did this or collected money or is a relative of so-and-so, and use that to rule against the complainant. So we have to be open and say, if I have good evidence against a member of the judiciary, let me take it. And I'm saying this, even we lawyers are at fault because we deal directly with the judiciary. We also complain wildly. But when it comes to saying, I know that this judge is corrupt, you'll find very few lawyers, or hardly any, by the way, who come up and say, such a judge is corrupt, he's my evidence. Please proceed against him or her. It's very rare. So we have to be open. Otherwise, these complaints will remain in the air. It's not only the judiciary. People have said the police is corrupt, very corrupt. How many police officers have been netted out of our crying, you know? We cry, but it ends there because we don't go with the evidence. But we do actually participate. You meet a policeman, you say, here, he's kitu kidogo, and you go away because you believe that is the norm.
Someone will assume that even in cases of corruption in the legal fraternity, still it's excavated by between lawyers and judges. Still under the same framework, what do you think of the quality of lawyers that you've trained very many lawyers? What do you think of the quality of lawyers in our generation? Because there seems to be complaints about members of the bar and their integrity.
Yes, we are not. We cannot boast of a very clean bar society. That would be dishonest, and we are not very proud of the products, the current products. Things have changed greatly from the 60s and 70s when we had one faculty of law in the whole country and probably about three or four in the region. Producing our lawyers, and there was a lot of control. Control was concentrated on these few training institutions. Also, the standards of education were quite high. If you remember, in the parliaments we had in the 60s, we had people who had not gone beyond senior four debating excellently. If you went and read the Hansards of the 60s, you would imagine that this was a different breed. They must have been PhD holders. No, they were normal people who hadn't gone very far. But the standard of education was quite high. These days we get lawyers trained throughout up to university and the law school, law development center, who cannot even draft a letter. I'm ashamed to say so. But that's it. But also ethics, the problem of ethics is a national problem, not limited to lawyers. So we have standards going down, and also all through, including ethical standards. So we don't know where to start.
Professor, how can the quality be enhanced? Because initially the safeguard was pre-entry exams to LDC, but the politician seem to be arguing against that.
They do, and they have succeeded in suspending the pre-entry, which we thought was a measure not to ring-fence the profession, as so many people thought, but a measure to find out whether the education being imparted by our universities is of the same quality. So sitting together, these people from different universities after liberalization was going to be helpful. But by the way, it was also meant to be temporary, pending the development of checking on quality strictly without interference from anyone. If the quality control was perfected, to the extent of weeding out some of the universities that have no capacity without interference from the government, then there will be no need for pre-entry. But that was a stopgap. Right now, we simply have to watch and see where the profession will go, because every graduate now can proceed without the pre-entry exam. But coming back to your question, there is a lot that can be done. Again, it is openness. The good thing now is that our clients are aware. If we shortchange them, they know where to go. And there's a lot of complaints in the disciplinary committee of the law council, and we are proud that we are probably the only profession which disciplines its own people, self-regulation, because the law council is an institution of lawyers. So we deal with them. We have constraints in the law council. Again, because it is government funded, it is under the government, the money doesn't come in time, there's a shortage of staff. But if everything was right, a lot could be done to improve the profession.
Professor, how about the quality of the bench? Because in some cases, you've had members of the bench referring to rulings of judges as stupid orders, or court orders referring to them as stupid court orders. What does that speak of the quality of the bench, and how can that be rectified?
I think I don't see that there's much that is wrong with the bench. As I said, the complaint against the bench by we litigants, the normal people, is normally because we have lost. It's from that standpoint. If, for example, government loses a case, the bench becomes bad. They are their judgments are stupid. If I lose as an ordinary people, then the bench is bad. But if I mean I win, all praises. You've seen this. So the judiciary is in a tight situation. The people that are selected, have participated in the selection, go through thorough screening for their standards at the Judicial Service Commission. Then we know very well, but we don't know what is done, but we know very well that there are other measures at presidential level where people go through some screening towards their integrity, their royalty, and so on and so on. So they are capable. By the time, when you talk about capabilities through education, training, experience, they do have. But when you talk about integrity, that's another thing we've discussed, because that one is something else.
It's a personal thing. Yes. It's inbuilt in character. Yeah. Professor, the race, the Chief Justice will be retiring in no months, and you're a seasoned teacher. So many people have gone through your hands. Do you think the time has come for probably a more youthful CJ, or perhaps a female CJ, going by the profiles of people that you've trained over the years?
Well, I agree. I agree. We need judges who, first of all, we need judges who are mature, not necessarily age, but mature in thought, matured in approaches to life. People who are not going to get a job as such, but who are going to serve the nation. I think that is what in many cases leads to people who have matured by way of age. But that doesn't mean that a younger person cannot be a Chief Justice. We could do very well with a young person. We could do very well with a lady. We haven't had a lady Chief Justice. We had only a Deputy Chief Justice who is a lady. But ladies have the same capacities like us. They can do as well as we can do. I very much hope that this time round some ladies have volunteered by sending their names to the Judicial Service Commission to be considered for the post of Chief Justice. I hope that is the case. And if they meet the competition, because it's now competitive, several people forward their names to this commission, and they are interviewed. The commission assesses their qualifications, their experience, and so on, and select those whom they think do qualify. So I hope there is a lady and she will qualify. It will be no problem. And age wouldn't matter. The age is in the constitution. It is determined by the number, the experience. If you've been in the legal profession for more than 10 years, high court judge, more than 15 years, higher, it is there in the constitution. That term is now the age. So you may not necessarily have a person of 20 years going to serve, even if he or she managed to go through the legal system, the educational system, in a crash manner. There is a constitutional limit. Mm.
Perhaps by way of example, my imagination is that one of your students, the lead of the legislature, how you could give it as an example of assessing how such people could perform in the judiciary.
Yes,
as well.
That's a very good example. She's performed very, very well, not because she was my student, because of her ability, her integrity, abilities. She's functioned very well. She compares very, very well with the former speakers who have been men. So that's a good example that I've brought up, that we need them more and more, and we might even be better off with a lady president.
Indeed, we await the day when we shall have a lady president. Yes, yes. Professor, you've practiced the law for over 50 years under Katz, and one young people would be wondering, how have you been able to be consistent and persistent with success for those many years under the same, because today my father might be a lawyer, but the moment they die, probably the chambers phase out. And then also, with the challenges that COVID has brought, how do you think the fraternity is going to, or the profession is going to fare post-COVID?
Oh yeah, to a very wide question. To begin with, post-COVID has taught us we have to embrace new techniques of practice. We have to use technology more. We now know that we don't need to have flashy big offices. We can do with little space, and that we don't have to meet in those offices every day, provided we have the necessary equipment to continue working. COVID has taught us quite a lot. As far as practice continuously for a period of 50, continuously in the same firm, I think that is the question, for that long period, tells a lot about what we Africans do with our practice, with our business, because in many cases we don't trust each other. These long-lasting companies come out of mutual trust and also foresight that anything can happen to we, the founders, but we don't need the firm to collapse. So that foresight makes you get partners who will stay with you for quite some time. So we have this mutual trust, and we have the commitment for continuation. Trust is just like a good marriage. You know, you live together with someone for 20, 30, 40 years, 50, and some people would start, the younger generation always ask questions how someone, a man and a woman, can live together for 50 years. They can't imagine it. But that is because they have made that commitment that theirs is a lasting relationship. Now, without trust, of course, many firms have collapsed. Or out of suspicions, maybe out of actualities, they have collapsed. After 2, 4, 5 years, you find that there's a firm that it was a strong firm, but it has disbanded or broken up into other pieces. So because of this trust that we built up with the founding partners and now with the other partners, we think we can even go on for another 50 years. God willing.
God willing. We are going to go for a very short break, but when we return, we are going to continue speaking to Professor Frederick Sempewa of Katende and Sempewa Kampan Advocates about constitutionalism and the challenges in COVID. Let's break. Welcome back from that very short break. You're still watching The Checkpoint, and today we are hosting Professor Frederick Sempewa of Katende and Sempewa Company Advocates, and we are discussing constitutionalism in the face of COVID-19. Professor, we seem as a country to be men in uniform, seem to be taking up responsibility in almost all sectors of the country, including beauty pageants. What do you think about the future of democracy in Uganda?
Well, I wouldn't have any quarrel with men in uniform participating in social life and so on. But their core activity, of course, the constitutional and legal activity is well delineated. They enforce the law, the police, they defend the integrity of the nation, the sovereignty of the nation, that's the army. They improve behaviors of people who have been condemned, the police, I mean the prisons. So that is their core activity. But it doesn't mean that they can't participate in other activities. Armies all over the world come in cases of emergency, for example. They can be used to construct roads, bridges. They have that ability. But I think the complaint could be that there should not be militarization of politics. The military and police has no role in politics other than ensuring that there is law and order, peace and stability, and no interference from outside the nation. But when law enforcement officers come in as if they have taken sides towards one political group or another, that one has to be condemned. That one I've got issues with, not merely participation in social matters. Because they are Ugandans, you cannot prevent them from participating in social activities. Just as you cannot prevent them from participating in politics when they want, and they take down their uniforms, they can participate in politics. So maybe I didn't understand the question, but that's the way I see it.
Professor, if you met your friend President Museveni today, what would you say to him?
Obviously, I would thank him a lot because he has done a fantastic job to redeem this country from where it had sunk in 1986 up to this level is something. I'm not saying that he alone has driven the change, but he has been in the leadership. All of us have participated in changes, everyone, but his leadership matters. And he has provided that leadership up to a point that Uganda has come to the front and we can walk outside the country and proudly say, I'm a Ugandan. We had stopped doing that. I would go out of the country and feel ashamed to say I'm a Ugandan. And I would, in some cases, say I'm an East African. But all that done, after thanking him, I would proposed to him that his legacy would be greater if he stepped aside and actually that would solve a lot of these suspicions that have been going on among us, people who want to access power. They would lose very fairly without him. Right now they have a lot of excuses that there's a power of incumbency because he has lasted there, he is in control of the instruments of power. Who else can defeat him? These are suspicions he would remove by setting aside and looking on and waiting for people to consult him with all that experience of his.
Is his longevity perhaps the reason as to why at some point you declined to take up positions of responsibility in ministries and the judiciary at some point. What had you read into his leadership?
Well, I've never rejected take up responsibilities because of long stay in power. We belong to different political inclinations. And I am a person of integrity. If I belong to a particular inclination, I stick to it throughout my life. And if I accepted a responsibility, I will not lose this integrity. I would simply, at the slightest mistake, I would say, that is a mistake. So I fear that serving in the government, I wouldn't last there. Because I would be always pointing out this and that and that and that mistake. And that probably will require me to resign, because there is, once you are serving in government, there is a responsibility you must take. If things are going wrong, you must own them and stay there. For example, the cabinet, we call it cabinet responsibility, decisions taken there. Even if you have agreed in cabinet, you must go out and support them. Probably I wouldn't manage that. So that is my inclination. It's not because Museveni is there where has lasted long. No. I would rather that I go into a situation where I'm free and I don't lose my integrity.
Professor, as we are winding up, what are some of the life lessons that you would leave for your younger viewer out there? Because this is an urban station, so you imagine that you're speaking to a younger generation. What life lessons can they pick from you?
I would tell the young generation, please, first of all, be patient with your life, but also strive for improvement at every level. Be patient, I mean, don't think you can achieve 100% in one day. There's a limit to what you can achieve. If you think that, for example, you're a lawyer, you've just got out of law school, and you think that you'll have a firm that resembles a Katende Sembewon company, you might be wrong, unless you have a backing that we cannot explain. That's what I mean by being patient, but also striving to improve from a beginning up to a position where you think that you can now compare favorably with the people who have been there before. Integrity, please. This is something that I would recommend. Strive to keep your integrity, because that is what builds up your legacy. Otherwise, you run into a lot of problems. But also, and this one, the young people don't need a lot of advice on it. Embrace change. For them, they can easily embrace change. The younger you are, the easier for you to embrace change. And this we've seen through experience. So embrace change, be patient, but strive for a better life.
You in particular, are there any lessons that you've picked from this COVID crisis?
I have. And our life is going to change a lot. We've been, for example, at having luxury functions like weddings, introductions, and so on. I believe, and I would very much pray that these don't come back. We don't need them. We don't need them. Even funerals had become a celebration, and people would collect money and have this celebration involving so many people. And I hope this will not return. So these are changes. The introduction, had departed, me and my Muganda, our introductions were not supposed to be this public affair.
So they should adopt the scientific weddings like the president.
Scientific weddings and a scientific introduction. We had it in Buganda, by the way. There was no, if you went to Kwanjula, you had to go with maybe 2, 3, 4 people who would keep the secret in case you have failed in your mission. But now there is no secrecy because girl and boy already know that they are acceptable to the parents. Hence, this a lot of celebrations. So we have our lives have got to change, and I hope we will not go back to that we have developed beyond it. But of course, as I said at the opening, the mode of work, approach to life and so on has also going to change.
Has got to change. Professor, do you have any plans for retirement? Perhaps a book. We've had very many prominent people that sometimes retire and they don't leave anything in ink that is referred to, and knowledge, very vast knowledge, is lost in thin air.
And Corvin has helped me about that because I've been doing a bit of writing. I'm not saying I've been very happy about COVID, but I'm not lamenting too much because I've been quite busy and trying to recall what I've done and putting it in black and white. So I am happy. I hope that I don't go away before I have at least done that. Left, yes. Yeah.
Professor, thank you very much for making time to the show. We are really delighted to have you today. Dear viewer, that's all we had for you today. We've been speaking to Professor Frederick Sempebwa. He's a seasoned lawyer. He has taught very many people. And he's the founding partner of Katende and Sempebwa at the company Advocates. Be sure to catch us tomorrow, same time. Keep it above.